What's up, guys? In this video, I want to talk about some ways that you could test old film cameras. And now, I want to preface the whole video with, I am not a camera technician. I am not the be-all, end-all authority on fixing cameras or testing cameras out. I'm just some guy on YouTube who likes to tinker with old cameras. But I think in making this video, it might be helpful to some people, and I'll just take you through some of the things that I do when I go through and test cameras. Now, at eBay and yard sales, secondhand stores, there's like a treasure trove of old film cameras that a lot of times are listed as, you know, as is, not tested condition, but they're actually really, there's nothing wrong with them, and they're fine, and they're totally operable and functional. And that's where I think you can really find some good deals are some of these ones that are marked as not tested. Now, you're gonna find some duds, okay? Honestly, there's some crap out there. But I think if, you know, you go through a process and test some of them out, you know, more times than not, you might find a gem. The two types of cameras that I'll be talking about here are standard point and shoots, like your automatic point and shoot, nothing much to them, and then an SLR that has more of like a fully manual control. The first thing that I would do, usually after buying a camera, or if I'm in a store and it's like a secondhand shop or a flea market or something, is just kind of look at it, really. You know, look at it, listen to it, feel it, and does anything look off? You know, check all the dials, turn all the knobs. If you can, you know, advance the shutter, put it through if it's automatic, force it to rewind. So you can kind of listen to the motor, because that's the one thing with old point and shoots as they age. I mean, they're not designed to last forever. Okay, some of these old mechanical SLRs will outlive a point and shoot with a motor 3-4 times over, but you know, just keep that in mind that, you know, some of these motors, you kind of hear it, you know, if they get like windy or like, I don't know, if they sound weird or off or grindy, if they sound bad, they're probably bad. So the first thing I do is hit all the knobs, touch all the dials, and just try to listen to it and see if you can kind of get a feeling of if this, you know, is in good condition or not. Now, with any camera that has exposure capabilities, or if it has auto feed or rewind, like a motor in it, it's going to take batteries. So, you know, open up the battery compartment and take a look in, because sometimes what you might find is, you know, somebody may have left an old set of batteries in there and they've leaked. So you get some corrosion or you get some, you know, battery acid in there. But, you know, it's not all lost at this point, because some of that can actually be cleaned up with like a Q-tip and some white vinegar. And when it comes to testing the exposure, you're kind of limited on point and shoots, because they're pretty much going to expose for what they think the scene is going to be. So you really don't have that control like you would with an SLR that has, you know, a manual function. What you can do, though, is, you know, take a picture and take another picture with a camera that you know exposes correctly, maybe a digital camera. Or you know, a phone, or anything that you know takes a properly exposed picture, and then just kind of compare the same scene against what you're shooting in that with the point and shoot, and that could be a good way to tell, okay, you know, this is underexposing a little bit, or it's spot on, you know, just do that comparison. If you have a camera with manual exposure capabilities, you can actually go through and test not only the auto exposure, but you can go through and just see how some of the shutter speeds are reacting as well. What I like to do with cameras with manual control is I'll go through and I first take a exposure reading with my meter, my light meter, just to make sure, you know, okay, this is where I need to be. So I take my settings from the light meter, which I know are the correct settings to give me a properly exposed image, and I'll set that through my manual controls on the camera. I take a couple shots in a row just so I know, you know, where on the film roll it is. And so in this case, it was F11, ISO 400 at 1/1000th of a second. So after taking a few of those correct exposures, I'll go through and then I'll move it to the automatic function. And then I'll take a couple shots there. And I take note, where is the meter? If I have in the viewfinder, any kind of notification of what the camera is telling it, you know, telling me it should be, I'll compare that, you know, the auto meter exposure to the light meter exposure. And then I'll take a couple shots there. Then I'll move back to my correct exposure, F11 ISO 400 at 1/1000th. And then I will do a sequential row of shots, leaving my aperture in the same spot. And I will be moving my shutter speed. So I will be at F11, and then I'll take a shot at 1/1000th. Then I'll move my shutter speed to 1/500th. Then I move it to 250th, and so on and so on. And I just, you know, I go down the line there. And what I want to see in the sequence of shots is a gradual difference in exposure. So after taking a sequence of shots with my with changing the shutter speeds, I'll then do a couple with the exposure compensation. So I'll throw the camera back into automatic, and I will reduce my exposure compensation by 2 stops. I'll take an image, and then I'll add 2 stops. So I go, you know, less 2 stops, then I'll go and I'll plus 2 stops, and then I'll drop it back in the middle. So and again, I want to see that difference in the exposures. Now for cameras with interchangeable lenses, I like to pop the lens off and just kind of inspect the lens as well. And sometimes what you might find is that you have kind of oil or a residue on the aperture blades, which sometimes it can kind of make, you know, sometimes it doesn't cause any issue, but other times it can kind of cause that diaphragm to stick and get stuck at a certain aperture. And there's ways to, you know, take lenses apart and clean, you know, clean the aperture blades, but just one other thing to look out for. Now again, these are just basic function checks that you could do when you get a camera. They're not specifically technical per se. There are ways to test your shutter speeds for accuracy, test the electrical circuitry of the camera. You know, all that stuff is just, it's kind of, you know, beyond the scope of this video. What I'm, you know, hoping here with this video is just to provide some insight as to, you know, an easy way to kind of check a camera and, you know, some of the ways that I've checked cameras in the past. But with that said, if you guys have some methods that you use that, you know, is particularly helpful, please, you know, put them in the comments below, and maybe this could be a helpful resource for somebody. So that's pretty much going to wrap it up for me, guys. Hope everybody's well. Hey, you know what? I forgot the whole ask for the like smash. If you could do me a favor, if you could, like a sledgehammer, smash that like button. I hope everybody's well. And I can't talk today. Until the next video, we'll see you. Smell that flash.